नमस्ते, जय शिवाय। वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, पॉलिसीज एंड लॉज टुडे, एंड हाउ ऑल दैट वॉज क्रिएटेड इन द मॉडर्न वर्ल्ड दैट वी आर लिविंग इन, एंड ऑल द प्रॉब्लम्स दैट एक्चुअली आर ओनली एंड ओनली बिकॉज ऑफ द these constitutional errors and then policy making errors. So I'm doing this work with G20, right? So it's all about making changes to the policies, existing policies that are there. But what is the framework that you use in order to create the policies, or what is the framework that should be used to actually create a constitution for a country, any country for that matter? Okay, so what was the source of it? So I thought of doing some sort of a course on doing the policy making and trying to see what these people are doing, why the policies are the way they are, and why are they being modified by using the references to all some of the modern studies here and there, the research that are done here and there, and then they will, every time they'll modify something in the policy. Policy could be about health, could be about education, or could be about, you know, philanthropy and sustainable goals. These are the three areas that I am involved with G20. And I realized that, you know, it's a very, very much a messed up world when it comes to policy changing, because at times policies, amending the policies or making changes and reforms, they are not actually driven by dharma. They are not going to cause 100% human welfare. Instead, are going to create a divisive humanity, divisive society, divided society in their country, wherever these policies will be implemented. And at times, the agenda or the source of these policies, amendments that are being done, they could be because of, you know, what would benefit the pharma industry if we make these kind of health reforms, then what would, how would it benefit the pharma industry that goes on? How, if we change these educational reforms, if we make these reforms, change the policies, then what will be the benefit of all those people, those who are doing the education of business, especially the large universities in the world? And some of the colleges and privates, and even the children education, and putting the as a small as 2-year-old child into some school and feeling very proud about it. What are these things do? How do these things impact the society or the world that we live in today? Now, from the spiritual point of view, this is very important thing to learn. Why? A lot of social conditioning happens in lot of you, okay? And when we are walking the spiritual journey, that social conditioning has to be broken. So what may be a really adharmic, unjust thing, but has been provided in the country or has been done to the country through the means of constitution, will become a social conditioning in you. So that is, these are some of the examples that I'll cite here, and I'll show you how things have changed and why they would have changed. And let's just take the example of Article 14 and Article 15 in the Indian constitution. Okay, so these two Constitution 14 and 15 clearly states that in India, minority religions will be allowed to have their own schools, funds, and they will be able to give their religious teaching to the children. So now, who are the religious minorities in India? The Christians and the Islamic people. So they can have their mosque or madrasas, and in the madrasas they can teach their Quran. And if it is a Christian school, convent school, then they can teach their Bible. But constitutionally it says that the other public schools that are being run by the Indian government will not be provided any support for the religious studies. Religious studies will not happen there. So, in other words, Hindu Dharma teachings or the Dharmic teachings, the real teachings that are there for the welfare of the entire humanity, will not be taught in public schools on the name of India being a secular country. Now, people forget here that the word secular was actually created in Europe while all the Europeans were fighting the church. So for the between the two powers of the church and the power of the state, there are books on that. You can read Women, Church and State by I'll put the book's names in the description box, so you can read some of the books to understand how the secular word actually came into existence and what it means. Very easily, even Indians today, ignorant Indians today, would very proudly say, no, India is a India is a secular country. What do you mean by secular? In India, there was no such thing as an organized power of church, the organized power of Islam or mosque. There was nothing like that. So then why was the need to even use the word secular? What do you mean by secular there? So the context went wrong, first of all. And the constitution itself was created by copying the constitution from the European countries. That is all. That's the constitution that you see around the world in most of the countries today. Wherever constitutional amendments have not happened, or you will see a really communist kind of a constitution where the state power is actually suppressing the religion or dharmic living, and all the agendas are just the state power driven in communism, right? So communism, Islam, Christianity, these were the three powers against which this term secular was actually created. And we end up using it in any and every place. Even for all the indigenous cultures, indigenous people in Australia or the Native Americans in America cannot practice their own religion, cannot have their own school on the name of being secular, right? They cannot have that. But at the same time, Christianity can have their convent school and can teach Bible there. Islam can have their madrasas and they can teach Quran there. So these two can propagate their teachings, whatever they are. However much they have benefited the university, there is an article that I wrote that the world should actually be stripped off of all the religion and what actually religion means and what actually dharma means. If you have not seen the previous talks, please go ahead and watch them first to understand, to have a deeper understanding of what is dharma. Dharma is not religion, right? So all this has happened. The constitutional errors have happened. And that way, whatever was good for the welfare of the humanity, that have been constitutionally stripped off from the society. Now, however many educational policies you make, that doesn't matter. Because the constitutional error has happened, now the policies will go on putting a band-aid after band-aid after band-aid after band-aid. That is what all policies will come to in the end. Exactly in the same way. So first on top we have constitution, then we have policies, then we have laws, and then we have regulations to comply with those laws, or compliance kind of regulations are there. Regulatory bodies are there. So these are the four governing things that make up the governance structure of the entire society for a particular country and a state and a place and a city and so on. So you see, now if the policies are sort of putting a band-aid onto the constitutional error, now there will be laws doing exactly the same thing. Now you will have to think about whether I create a law which will be in favor of one community versus the other community. So you have created a divide right then and there. In the entire society, there is a divide now. And everything has turned adharmic, which is exactly opposite of human welfare. Now let's take another example. Yes, now this time let's talk about laws. So in India, the law that was created, the Hindu Marriage Act that was created, again, they copied a lot of things from here and there. And the marriage says that, you know, this is the registered kind of marriage needs to happen in order for a child to be born legitimately, okay? And legitimate and illegitimate child, these are the words that are used in the law. And then if these are the, and then the any illegitimate child is not going to have claim on the inheritance of the parents. As simple as anything. Again, such a huge mistake that has happened. Why? How adharmic, first of all, inhuman it is, first of all, to call a life as legitimate or illegitimate. How mentally sick is that, that you call the children vaidhanik or avaidhanik, right? Avaidh children, illegitimate children. First of all, let's see again. You have to go back to the history of humanity. You have to read a lot of European history to understand the background of how these terms came into picture. So these terms of having legitimate child, illegitimate child, these actually come from the constitution and laws of the European people. And they created this in a very sinister way to just degrade woman, keep her down, and to put every blame of men onto the woman. Real division has happened in the society just because of this wrong constitution and the wrong laws that we have related to marriages. Now, we also need to understand that source of constitution, the source framework of the constitution, or the source framework of the policies, the source framework of the laws, cannot be anything that is adharmic. All the Western countries especially were created in a very adharmic way. Just by invading here, invading there, looting here, looting there. What kind of constitution you think will come out from all that kind of a human history? Same thing with the Islamic history. Everywhere, wherever you go, there is still a war going on. There is still a fight going on. There is still a crisis going on. It is all so much against humanity. What kind of constitution, laws and policies will come out from that mindset? Half of the world problems are only and only because the source of constitution, policies and laws is wrong, is adharmic in the first place. Now, no matter how much band-aid you do, how much you change, it requires some serious thought. It requires some serious major changes into the constitution, at the level of the constitution, at the policy level and at the laws level. It requires, and then comes the regulations and compliance part, everything. Now let's talk about what are the correct sources of these things, right? So the correct sources of these things are actually 9 Smritis and 7 Dharma Shastras that we have, that are only and only there in Hindu Dharma, nowhere else. And they are purely based on human welfare. They are purely based on dharma. And if the society is set up, if the constitution is set up according to that framework, if the policies and laws are made accordingly, if that is being used as a source, then social divisions will not happen. A lot of problems that we see in the society today will not happen at all. And I'm going to read the names of these Smritis, so that some of you can pick up something someday and actually start reading these Smritis and the Dharma Sutras, and someday will come up with the, those who are especially studying law, studying constitution, studying, doing legal and paralegal kind of studies, you should be able to change the framework. You should be able to create the correct frameworks using these ancient documents. So, one of them is Yagyavalakya Smriti, Narada Smriti, Brihaspati Smriti, Angira Smriti, Manu Smriti, Shankh Smriti, Parashar Smriti, Katyayan Smriti and Daksha Smriti, which is especially about marriages, all 8 different kinds of marriages all 8-9 different kinds of children that are born from those marriages, and what are the rights on inheritance, rights on money, the rights to education, the rights to live and breathe and be able to call themselves as valid in the society, right? So these are the smritis, and based on these smritis we have dharma sutras. So one of the dharma sutra is Gautama dharma sutra, then Bodhayan dharma sutra, Apastambha dharma sutra, Hiranyakeshi dharma sutra, Vashishtha dharma sutra, Vishnu dharma sutra and Shankh dharma sutra. I will provide the names of these dharma sutras and smriti in the description box in case you guys want to do a detailed study of these things. So let's talk a little bit about the marriages. So 8 different kinds of marriages were permitted in the ancient Hindu world, and it's not that ancient actually, because till, you know, 17th century, 18th century, all these was still being practiced. That is how the social setup was in India. So it hasn't gone that we don't have to go back all the way to 1000 years old or 500 or few thousand years old. It's not that old of a matter. It's just a matter of hardly 200-250 years that we have been adopted the things from the Western countries. So not everything that you adopt from the Western country is going to be the good thing or bad thing for the humanity. Instead, West should be adopting it from the Eastern thing. But first of all, Eastern people have to get up and stand up and say, okay, this is the right way to do thing. This is the right framework to create a constitution or to make changes into the constitution so that it doesn't create more divide into the humanity. Now, how many of you, I have met a lot of people who think they were the, who know that they were the illegitimate child from their mother. Their father disowned them, or that they were born out of the love affair that has happened after the marriage, this, that. No. All kinds of marriages and all kinds of, children being born are permitted in the society. It even permits the Gandharva Vivaha. One is one of the Vivaha where they say that, okay, so you were in love with somebody and your child has born before you could actually be married. Now here they are not talking about the 9th kind of marriage which actually happens in the Indian court or any court, a registered marriage, court registered marriage. It's not about that at all. It's all about when you actually take the Saptapadi, the Sat Fere that we call it. So Saptapadi, and all the mantras are there and everything is being done properly. A yajna is going on. Kanyadan through a parent is happening. All that is happening. That is considered as Hindu Vivaha. And on the name of marriage, what we are doing in Indian society today, it just sickens my mind. What kind of things that are being done. And then, and the reason for doing that was 3. Number one, to do all those traditional karmkand, the traditional yajna, havan and everything. All these rituals were very conscious for 2-3 reasons. Number one reason was so that the couple become a much better being that they are today. That's what the purpose of marriage was and doing all those rituals was. Another reason was so both of them together can actually do a lot of dharma work, society work, betterment of humanity. They can live for that. A lot of dharma work can be done in the society. People can do daan, people can do this, people can do that. And both of them as a grahastha, they should be doing it together, right? So that was the another thing, that the mantras and everything was being done. Third reason that those rituals were being done is so that a very good human being as an atma takes birth through you. And that is such an important thing. Why? I meet a lot of parents whose children have committed some crime. Just see what happens to those parents, those whose children are jailed or have gone through some police case, some court case, some trouble they have been making, and parents' life is just devastated. The entire family's life is devastated because of what the children has done, what they have committed. And parent might be simple people. So you see, The third reason, most important reason, what kind of a human beings takes birth from you? That was such an important factor while doing all those yajnas, all those homas and all those rituals, and that was the reason for marriage. So even for the Gandharva marriage, where two people are secretly meeting and they became intimate and they had a child as a result. So even that child was called as valid. And that person, sooner or later, the father and the mother both have to own the child. The father has to provide everything, education, and make that child as a part of your inheritance. These days, a lot of court cases happen in the court. Why? Because this guy was not the legitimate child of my father, so we are not giving him any part of the inheritance. Inheritance only belongs to us. No, that is such an adharmic thing to do with another human being. So you see, problems in the society, how many problems have been created in the society just because of this wrong adharmic law that says a life to which a Paramatma is giving birth, the creator of the universe is permitting to come in this world. Human beings, some petty human beings, some shitty laws will decide whether that life is legitimate or illegitimate. Even till today, how much shame and guilt is there in lot of women who became mothers without proper marriage, before the marriage, or who have children born because of some kind of a sexual abuse. Some rape has happened, something has happened, and they went on dying in shame, and whole life they are in the trauma because of saying what the society will think. Now we forget to understand here that this society is completely based on adharmic laws. For this mindset has been cultivated adharmically into the entire humanity on this planet, where regardless of whether it, and I'm here not talking about just the Indian woman feeling guilt of having child before marriage or out of the relationship if a child has happened. So then I'm not saying just the Indian woman, a lot of Westerners, a lot of women from America, from Europe actually come to me because they are dying from that guilt that they gave birth to a child outside their marriage. No, there's no such thing as illegitimate child. And there is no such a thing as, you know, child not having a father's name is considered as illegitimate. No. If God has allowed, if Paramatma has allowed a child to be born, child to happen, a life to happen, who are you to say it's valid or invalid, it's legitimate or illegitimate, it's Vedic or, you know, Avaidh or Vaidh or Samvidhanik or Asamvidhanik. How can you use these terminologies? Definitely read a book called Church, Woman and State. Definitely read that book and you will understand where does this concept of illegitimate child comes from. It's the most sickening thing in the society. Where a life has happened and you are, the moment it has happened, you are labeling that child as an illegitimate child. In Mahabharata, Karna was born from Kunti before marriage. Did we call Karna as Avaidhik or Asamvedhanik? Nobody called him that way. Nowhere in Mahabharata it says, you were born to Kunti before her proper marriage to, you know, Maharaj Pandu or somebody and you cannot have this child. Does anywhere the Mahabharata says that? No. So not only these nine Smritis and seven Dharma Sutras teach us about how to set up the society properly, how to have a constitution that is not based on adharmic factors and adharmic frameworks, and how to set up policies, how to create laws which are beneficial for the entire humanity. Which are for the actual human welfare. Mahabharata does the same. Ramayana does the same. Everywhere, if you read it from the social science perspective, if you read it from the perspective of understanding These Mahabharata and Ramayana you can read from the perspective of understanding the how the social structure was, how what was the constitution in those places, what was the policies and what were the laws in those places. You can read it from that perspective as well, and you can very well understand that, you know, no, there was no such thing. So just by making a marriage registered and legitimate, to make it legitimate, make it registered, and when only when the marriages are registered by the court, then only it is going to, you are going to have been married properly, and you can have your passport only then, and you can have lot of things only then, and then it is connected to your child's legitimacy and illegitimacy, the life that you are going to bring on this planet. This is completely nonsense. Complete nonsense. A lot of people around the women around the world are being raped since centuries. And that happens more in the Western countries. Now, if out of emotion, if out of not being able to take care of being born, if you do not give birth to that child, that's a separate thing. But if it has happened, so what the marriage is, we really need to understand in a bigger concept. We need to have a dharmic concept towards marriage. Do not go towards what the constitution allows, what the policies and laws are saying. In Hindu Vedic Vivaha Parampara, okay, the proper marriage, Hindu marriage system, in the according to these dharma shastras and these shrutis, even after marriage you can have you not for the indriya sukh, okay, not for the indriya sukh, but you can have intimate relationships outside your marriage as well if there is a need. If your something has happened to your wife, or if something has happened to your husband, and you would, but by their knowledge, by their permission, and they should be. But people have been cultivated, people have been cultured a lot in that way. Okay, today we talk a lot about how marriages are being failed, how divorce has become a big business for the lawyer and for the city, state and country. The money goes to them, right? All the court fees that we are paying while going through a divorce is actually a business for the state, business for the country. Why? There was no such thing because there was no registered marriage. So the business of divorce did not exist back then. But that does not mean people were not breaking up the relationship if it went really south. That does not mean they were not having multiple affairs or wives. They cannot keep multiple people in their life for different purposes or for different reasons. They are not saying that, you know, children being born from this affair or that affair suddenly becomes illegitimate life on this planet. No. No such a thing was there. Even women were allowed. So this idea of what woman is allowed to do, what woman is not allowed to do. If you read the texts and books from the Western countries, you are going to get, you know, programmed in a very, very bad way, very sick way. So to understand what the streetva is, what the femininity, true femininity is, what it is, what it was, how it was being a woman in India back in 1700s, 1600s, 1300, 1400, way back in time. What was it meant? And exactly in the same timeline, 1400, 1600, 1700, 1800, what it meant to be a woman in any Western country, especially the European culture and European places. It was sick. It was sick. Just read it. So all these social conditioning and all these social boundaries that exist, that have been, you have to understand by reading all these texts, that all these have been put to us, have been programmed into us through the Western culture. Nowhere it exists, the samaj vyavastha, okay, the social conduct, the social boundaries, the things, nowhere it is bahupatni vivah, bahupati vivah, everything was allowed. Everything was for people only know of Draupadi having 5 husbands. There are many others who had even 10 husbands. And there are valid, justified reasons, dharmic reasons for doing so. So people need to widen up their mental horizon by reading the actual smritis and dharma shastras and understand what is constitutionally protected or lawfully protected or, you know, lawfully being perpetuated in the society may or may not be dharmic all the time. Just because it has been put into the constitution or policy or a law or a regulation or into some kind of other governance structure, if it has put into that, then it's a valid thing. It's dharmic as well, you know. It's justified for, and it's for the human welfare of all. No, don't think like that. The worst mental block that you will have. And a lot of social conditioning happens because of this. Guilt comes, shame comes, love marriage or Gandhar Viva or this marriage or that marriage or this kind of children, that kind of children, or this education, that education. Everything becomes a social conditioning. And yogis have to break all these social conditioning from their mind. So do read about all these, especially if you want to read about all different types of marriages, eight different kinds of marriages, and 9-10 different kinds of children that can be born, that are born out of those marriages and stuff. Then do read Daksha Smriti. Okay, Daksha Smriti must be read. So think about it and break those social boundaries that you have in your mind and successfully walk your spiritual journey. Namaste. Jai Shivaya.